Hello and good morning and welcome everybody. Thank you for joining us for our employability webinar series. We are now on week two and today we'll be covering getting to grips with interviews. So just want to go through some housekeeping with you all first. So if you can see my screen, so if you can please just ensure that you have the correct audio setting. So if you just go to your settings and we'd recommend selecting computer audio. Bear with us, we are all working from home today. So obviously do allow for any interruptions or any connectivities. We're at home. You might hear a few birds in my background because there tends to be quite a lot outside, but just do bear with us, we are working from home. Please do enter any questions that you have. As you can see, there's a screen on the box. We will be looking at answering any questions that you may have at the end of the presentation. Also, if you do have any technical difficulties or anything throughout, just pop a question into the box and one of my colleagues will be able to help you. We'll also have a survey at the end, so we'd appreciate it if you can answer the survey as well, because any feedback for us will be greatly appreciated. So just to start off with, I'm going to give yourself a quick intro on myself and my colleague that will be leading today. So hi everybody, I'm Rushnara. I'm one of the resourcing advisors for the trainee team. And what that means is I look after all trainee vacancies that covers school leavers and graduates, as well as placements and internships. I'm responsible for looking after roles in Birmingham and the Southwest. It's now my third month here at Grant Thornton and so far so good. So my background is in recruitment and employability. So hopefully, you know, I've picked up a couple of things along the way that I can share with you today. I've previously worked at a university where I've advised students on finding jobs, helping them get prepared for graduate positions. So hopefully with my knowledge and background from that, I'll be able to share a few things with you today. So over to Matt.
Morning everybody. Hi, my name is Matthew Barnard, or honestly feel free to call me Matt. Everybody does. So I'm Matt Barnard. I've been with Grant Thornton for, best part of 5 years. And I look after the London business, a part of the business called advisory, which personally I find absolutely fascinating. So that would include areas such as internal audit, financial crime. They do things such as actuarial and risks. There's lots of different sort of guises that these guys and girls do. And from my own perspective, I find it absolutely fascinating. Me personally, I've worked within talent acquisition, and I don't really want to give my age away here, for the past sort of 16 years. So I'm quite sort of seasoned in this area. And in this time, I've worked with a number of candidates. So people who are literally just starting out their journey, so starting their career, to more of the seasoned professionals. So people who are at different stages in their career. So I've worked through the whole of the employee life cycle.
Okay, perfect. So today's agenda for the day. So today we're going to cover an introduction into interviews and why employers do use interviews. We'll explore various different types of interviews, focusing on a few that we think would be useful to you. We'll cover how to prepare for interviews, giving you some great interview tips and techniques. So hopefully from today you can take away a few things that will be useful to you. We're going to end with a Q&A and we'll have Richard, who's our head of resourcing, that will be joining us. So if you can think of any questions, as I mentioned earlier, pop into the box. So myself, Matt and Rich will be on hand to be able to answer any questions that you may have. So Matt, if you would like to get us started.
Yeah, so why interviews? Look, this is something that I'm pretty passionate about. I've got to be completely honest with you. I think it's really important to think of an interview as a two-way process, and not enough people think of it as a two-way process. Basically, I mean, if you think about it like this, there is basically you and the interviewer. And I think what people do tend to forget is it's an agreement. So let me sort of just elaborate on this slightly. So number one, does the potential person that you're interviewing with, the interviewer, do they like you? Do they think you're going to be a good fit for the company? Do they think you've got the right skills for the role? But actually, more importantly, which I think everybody is guilty of forgetting, is actually, is this a company that you want to work for? Is this an individual that actually you want to work for? So actually, you know, and I think that what people do tend to forget, and I think sometimes as interviewers, we can be guilty of this as well. But we need to appreciate that this is an agreement for both parties, and we need to make this work. So what this is basically going to do, if we think about the interviewer side, okay, so this gives the interviewer an opportunity to find out more about you. you're going to give you the suitability for the role. So they're going to, you know, assess all the way through the process, are you suitable for the role? They've seen something in you that they want to call for an interview. So you must have something right. Also, I think, you know, it's very important that the interviewer is going to be really keen to understand and to appreciate how you feel and how you're going to respond in sort of certain situations. Sometimes there isn't a right or wrong answer around this, but they're just quite, you know, keen to understand how you will react. The interviewer would also be keen to understand, you know, your achievements. So I can't stress enough, guys and girls, please do think about what you have done. But the most important thing is be proud of what you've done. Highlight them, shout about them. The interviewer is going to be really keen to understand your communication style. So what I would certainly recommend is be clear, be concise, but more importantly, be considered in your answers. The interviewer is going to also be keen to understand what you like and what you don't like. So if I think about myself, and something I'm always very guilty of is I'm not very good with technology. That's by all means a weakness. So something I'm always have to, like, you know, work with sort of, you know, the ever changing sort of technology. But more importantly, and I can't stress this enough, everybody on this call, you are so important that you've got to remember that actually you're just as important as the interviewer. Is this somebody that you really want to work with? You know, ultimately only you can answer yourself that, you know, that question. Actually, does the organization, do their beliefs align with you and what you stand for? And again, you know, please do you know, think about when you're interviewing, you're also interviewing the company as well. So if we go on to the next slide. Yeah, so there's different types of interviews. So there's many different types of interviews that you can encounter on your recruitment journey. And these range very much from competency-based interviews to strength-based interviews to digital interviews and to group exercises. But this morning, what we're going to focus on specifically is competency-based interviews and strength-based interviews, the first two. We're going to hopefully give you some tools, some tips, some ideas on hopefully how you can ace this interview. So competency-based interviews. Okay, so this is a type of interview. What it basically is the easy way to think about it is this will give you the opportunity to discuss your experiences that you've had to date. It doesn't actually matter if you've not had work experience, but they're quite keen to understand, you know, your experiences that you had throughout your life. So what I've tried to do is make this as an example that hopefully everybody can be part of. So please do bear with me on this one. So let's try and relate this to a time when you're at either school or at college or at university. So the first thing to think about in this competency-based interview is what qualities do you think you are going to bring to a task? Okay, so describe these. So perhaps, you know, you want to think about things such as leadership. Have you led on a team or on a project? Be you know, very clear about the sort of rationale, what you actually did. Perhaps, you know, you can think about some of your technical skills that you had, but more importantly, articulate and demonstrate what you have done. So I'm sure that you've done some great things, but sometimes, you know, you're just trying to bring these to life. Also, give an example of where you took a lead on a project. Okay, so perhaps did you have to, and again, you know, you want to perhaps take a step back on this and think, well, actually, you have some great technical expertise. So that's where your sort of skill set, or I suppose niche skill set, sort of came into play. Also, you know, what was actually required to complete this project? So this could have been where your technical expertise was I suppose, vitally important. Also as well, you know, think about a time when you overcame a difficult situation. Sometimes this is really difficult to do, and appreciate it's not easy by any, you know, stretch of imagination. But again, I think this comes back to the, you know, the clear thought process. How did you overcome the situation? What measures did you do to be successful at the end? So if we move on.
Okay, well, thanks for that, Matt. And as Matt said, remember that, you know, you have initially passed the first stage. So whether that have been an application form or sending your CV across, so you have done well to get to this stage. So strength-based interviews are designed to focus on what you enjoy doing rather than what you can do. So they do differ a little bit from competency-based. It also allows the employer to learn about what you're good at and what you're not so good at. So just what an employer or a recruiter is looking for when they're going to interview you. They like to consider what personal qualities you have and that will help you succeed. They also want to help understand who you are and what motivates and drives you. It's also good to establish a more accurate indicator of potential job performances from you based on the way you answer the questions. Also, what is the best job based on what your strengths are? So the job usually that are aimed at school leavers or graduate generally tend to be strength-based interviews, as they take into consideration that you may not necessarily have any work experience because you've been busy studying or you're a student and that's been your main focus point. The strength-based interviews are designed to sort of allow you to showcase experiences that you have, whether it's from a academic or a personal experience. So, for example, a question that you could get asked is, what subjects and topics do you enjoy learning and working with? And you might say you like maths because you like working with numbers. This shows that you enjoy working with calculations and are quite analytical. So, you know, potentially a job in accounting or data might be good to you. So just think about, you know, different things that you can pick up on. Also, another good example is what might get asked is, what kind of task boosts your energy? So you could, you know, example, you could say you enjoy playing sports, you're the captain of a university rugby team, and you enjoy entering, you know, tournaments as with your team. So that shows leaderships and qualities that you may be suited to within a role within management or working in a team environment. So it's really important to remember that a strength-based interview does focus in on things that you enjoy doing and what motivates you. Also, from the end of that, what you'll find is a strength-based interviews are generally designed to be a lot more friendlier, just more of a conversation piece. So the employers are really looking for things that you're good at, that you can display in the past, that will allow them to make any decisions based on different things you say. So the questions are done designed in that way. So moving on, I just want to talk a little bit about digital experiences. So digital interviews are becoming more and more common now. It saves time and resources, and it's a very useful tool. Usually with a digital interview, what you'll find is you are given a set of questions beforehand, and then you answer the questions by recording and presenting yourself on a camera and usually uploading it onto the portal. This is something we do here at Grant Thornton for our trainee position. And why we do that is just, it gives us an understanding of you. It allows us to establish and differentiate you between another candidate. It also adds a little bit of a human element to it. Obviously, by this point, we know what you are like on paper. We've read a CV and an application. So that digital interview really allows us to see a little bit more about what you're about, allows you to focus on some of the questions. It also gives us an understanding of how you answer them. Employees usually might use a digital interview as a first stage. So what you'll find is, if you've done an application form or a CV, normally you might then be invited to a digital before you're invited to a first stage. And then at a digital interview, it's really, really important that you tackle it and you do a digital interview as if it's a real interview. So some points to consider, just try and obviously enjoy it as much as you can. Remember, you are recording something, so your facial expressions, your body language, just showing that. So smile and try and enjoy it, a little bit like obviously today. It's like a presentation, I'd say. So if you've been at university or you've been at college and you've had to do group work, you've presented something, treat it something like that. Test your digital equipment beforehand. Check that your internet is working, that you're in a quiet environment and that you're not really going to get any distracted. So, you know, no knocking on your door, no cat or dog running around in the background. So that's kind of really important. Also, make use of the practice of the question. So usually they would have given you the questions beforehand, or about, you were allowed like 5 to 10 minute preparation hands. So really look at the questions and see how you want to answer them. Plan this beforehand. The other thing as well is, you can use notes, but just obviously bear in mind that, you know, you don't want to be looking as if you are constantly referring to your notes. So I think for a digital interview, it's a really good stance, and it really puts you, it really helps prepare you for like the second stage, or if you are going in for a face-to-face interview. So hopefully you would have done a digital interview and you've been successful. So now you're then invited to the next stage, which could be a group assessment a group exercise or an assessment day. Now, assessment days and group exercises are designed to help employees find the best candidates for the job vacancy. Usually what it will involve is activities, and multiple candidates are invited to that. And usually they're designed to try and assess various criteria, so multiple things that you normally won't probably get from a one-to-one interview. So they have been designed to try and get the most out of you, test you, that. As daunting as it sounds, I think it's a really good experience. And what you'll find, it's very common for a beginning job or for a graduate position. And then also what you'll find is if it's a graduate position, employers could be trying to fill multiple jobs, and it's a good way to be able to do that. So what to do? So treat an assessment day or a group exercise as you would any other interview. So it's really important that you prepare beforehand. So research the company, find out more about the role that you're going for, research all of that. Also, I think it's really important that you do utilize the resources that are available. So for us, for example, here at Grant Thornton, we do hold experience days. And, you know, my role would be inviting somebody to do that. So I think, I mean, any candidate that I'm inviting for an experience day, it's important that they take advantage of me in the nicest possible way, where they ask me as many questions as possible. So if you have been invited for a experience day, more often than not, it would probably have been for a recruiter, you know, contact them, ask them the questions, try and find out the layout of the day, the plan for the day, if they've got an agenda, they'll try and give you as much information as possible. It's also good to sort of get in contact with friends or people that you know that have attended before, just to try and get some understanding of what to expect behind them. So normally you've arrived at the day. So what can you expect from a day? Normally there will be a range of activities that will happen throughout the day. So for example, you could be expected to do a group activity, a presentation, case studies, role plays or tests. There are a number of different activities that could be, you know, provide that you would be able to do on the day. And normally what that's done is it's so an employer can look for a different things from these activities. So for example, they'll probably be looking to assess you on your communication skills, how well you work under pressure, planning, teamwork, sort of, you know, criteria around that. And the most important thing I will say is just be yourself, you know, ask questions. There are other people that are there on the day that are exactly at the same position as you. So try and draw them in as well for discussion, share best practice, you know, ask questions to them. You'll find that they can help you. In the past, I've previously hosted assessment days where one of our activities was a case study of a hotel. And as part of a group, you were able to present that at the end. And the reason why that we hosted that as an activity, because it really allowed us to, you know, assess for multiple criterias, and that included sort of communication, teamwork, how you worked well as part of that team, how you kept the time, because it was a timed exercise, and as well as personal presentation in the end. So I think what you'll find from a group exercise and assessment days, it's really important that, you know, you do plan and prepare for yourself, but also make the most of the opportunity and the experience there as well yourself. You know, you'll meet new people, you'll learn more about other people who are going to potentially be colleagues of yours in the future. You'll get to learn about the company as well from this experience day. So hopefully that tells you a little bit more about like types of interviews. Now, next we want to sort of go through, you know, different ways that you can plan and prepare for any interviews.
Right. So this one is, I have to admit, is one of my favorites. So I'm quite passionate about this slide. So please do bear with me on this one. So plan, prepare and practice. Right. Well, anybody would tell you, you will not be just doing this for interviews. You will be doing this in every day of your life, not just your career, but actually your personal life as well. So this is like a continuation of your journey. So, right, research the company. It sounds really straightforward, really basic, but the amount of people who don't research Grant Thornton when they come to an interview sort of astounds me, which is a tad sort of surprising. But there's so many great tools out there. You know, you can use social media. You can use the internet to do your research, but also, you know, actually think about looking on things such as, you know, if you've got the interviewer's name, have a look at LinkedIn, have a look at their profile, look at their background. You never know, they may have been to the same college as you or the same university. And again, that's not necessarily sort of, you know, being a stalker. I think it just shows sort of good preparation. But also as well, I mean, look, apart from using LinkedIn, think about, you know, using Glassdoor. Glassdoor is a great tool to, I suppose it's a tool that everybody has access to. It gives you a review and a synopsis of organizations. More importantly, research the role. I'm guessing a number of you would be applying for a number of roles. If I think back to when I graduated, sort of unfortunately almost many years ago, I was guilty of applying for many different roles because I just wanted a job. But actually, if I take a step back and actually reflect, did I really just hit the button just because I wanted to apply for a role and I wanted a job? I think if I was to sit back and reflect, how much research did I necessarily do on roles? So if I look right back at my early career, how actually my first graduate job was actually renting cars. Now, was that actually my dream job, or was it just that I needed a job? I think, you know, something which I should have done is actually research the role and actually think, actually, is this something that I really want to do? Prepare examples. And it is sometimes difficult as well, because, you know, if you haven't got that sort of network, you know, history, it is sometimes very difficult to think, well, crikey, I haven't got it, you know, experience of doing this part of the role. But actually, just think about tangible examples that actually are relevant and actually will make you a success in that job. I think this is something that, you know, we're all guilty of, is knowing your strengths and weaknesses. And everybody hates to admit weaknesses. It's human nature, isn't it? And actually, having a weakness isn't necessarily a bad thing. So don't believe, and please don't do yourself a disservice by thinking it's a negative thing to have. It's actually quite a positive, because you can turn this weakness into a strength. So for me, and again, I'm probably doing myself an injustice here, but I know for a fact that what I used to do was, and if I look at my early career, I didn't necessarily, you know, give enough time for meetings, and this could actually be applicable to interviews. So over the years, what I've done is I've sort of developed a mechanism to allow myself greater time to prepare for meetings. So what's the result of this? What does this necessarily mean for me? Well, it actually means that my meetings are more impactful. The person who I am meeting with, they are actually feel that they're making good use of their time, because I don't want to feel like I'm wasting their time. But actually, we just want to both walk away from that meeting knowing that we've both made a good use of each other's time. And the last one, this is what I can't stress enough. Practice, practice, practice. The amount of times that people sort of attend interviews and have never practiced, it is quite noticeable. So it sounds a bit, I've got a couple of cliches here. So practice does make perfect. Use your friends, relatives, or people in your network so you can help practice for the interview. And just remember, the biggest advice I can give is, if you do fail to prepare, please be prepared to fail. So if we just go on to the STAR technique. So this is a common sort of interview technique that is used at Grant Thornton. And we use this for a lot of our experienced hires. So in an ideal answer, candidates will, you know, they're focused very much on the STAR technique. And I'm guessing a lot of you perhaps wouldn't have heard of this. So please don't worry about it. I'm going to try and talk you through it nice and simply. So let's think about this in relation to attending an interview. So we're talking about interviews at the moment. So let's use the STAR technique and relate it to attending interviews. So situation S. Okay, you find yourself in a situation where you do not know where to find the office where you're interviewing, which wouldn't be a great start, would it? So your task, outline the task you need to complete to be successful in this case. So you need to get to the interview with plenty of time to spare. So what actions are you going to take? What did you do to ensure that you were successful? So you may have printed off a map with very, very, very simple directions to follow to get to the interview. And the upshot was you attend the interview on time. The results. So what was the result of your outcome? So if we think all the way back to what, you know, the situation that we were in, hopefully you got to the interview with plenty of time and you had a chance to secure the role. So if we take that step forward and reflect on all the previous actions, what do you think you could have learned from the situation, and what might you do differently next time? Okay, well, you've learned it's very important to plan, but did your plan consider different factors? So what happened if you were going on the train or you were driving by a car, but you had disruptions to the services? Have you come up with a plan B? So again, you know, please do think of like alternative routes, or you may have had to think about sort of different timings to get to the interview. So if you go on to the next slide. So interview tips. Again, this is something, again, I'm quite sort of passionate about. So apologies for this, but be on time. I can't stress that enough, guys. Just please make sure you are on time. Allow enough for unforeseen sort of circumstances. But the main reason why you want to make sure that you're on time is you want to come across as relaxed. So if we think about the next bubble, right, how are you presented for the interview? First impressions genuinely really do count. This is the first time that you would have met the interviewer. So me personally, I'm only talking about myself personally. I would not wear shorts, flip-flops or a t-shirt to an interview. Some people may, but I just want to feel comfortable in that way. But again, and I'm not saying that the interviewer may have judged me, but again, just please be conscious about how you are presenting yourself. Body language and eye contact. Again, this is really, really, really important. I can't stress how important this is. Think about positive body language. So don't slouch. So what I mean by slouching is perhaps like this, because you don't look particularly engaged. Make sure you're sitting up. Don't look bored. Look, try and articulate and show positive signs throughout. Don't stare, because that can be really off-putting to an interview, probably sort of slightly creepy as well. But more importantly, be really personable. And the last and the most important fact for all of this is stay calm, please stay focused. So there's two points here that we need to think about. Number one, do not have any distractions. So typically it would probably be a mobile telephone. Make sure you turn it off. And the second point, don't be afraid to take control. You've been called to the interview, so the company must see something in you that they want to meet you. So you're prepared for the interview. You've done all the great stuff that we've talked about previously in this seminar. You are a great candidate. There's no, they wouldn't be, calling you to an interview if you weren't a good candidate. You are a great candidate, but don't feel the need to rush through your answers. Take that clear and thoughtful and considered thought process throughout. On to the next slide.
Okay, so great, you've done the interview now. Wow, you can really, you can sigh, it's a sign of relief, but it's not necessarily over just yet. So I just want to cover a couple of things regarding what to expect after an interview. So it's just post interviews. So it's really important that you take any information that they've provided you on hand. So following up appropriately. So normally you probably may have been given a specific date for when you are to expect a response or when you'll hear back. So I would really advise waiting until that date has passed before you reach out, because the chances are that the company are still interviewing other candidates or they've got other factors that they need to consider, whether waiting from decisions or allocations from something else. So it's really important that, if you've been given a date of when to expect a result by, just wait for that date to pass. Having said that, it is also it's really important and it is allowed for you to make contact with the recruiter or the interviewer just to thank them. There's nothing wrong with you sending a follow-up email or just popping along a quick call to the employer or the recruiter just to thank them for their time, tell them how much you enjoyed the experience, and also it's a good conversation piece. It's also really good practice. What you'll find when you'll do that, a recruiter or the employer will genuinely be happy that you have reached out, and they'll take that feedback on board. And also that saying, out of sight, out of mind, so the more that you're in their mind, it's definitely a good thing. So like I said, there's nothing wrong with you just sending up a follow-up just to say thank you and just explain that you really did enjoy the interview process. The other thing is as well, I know now that the interview is over, you're probably thinking, okay, that's the end of it. I think it's really good that you do draw upon your experience from the day. So after your interview, it's really good that you create a list of things that you felt that you did well, as well as things that you feel that you could improve on. I think sometimes, you want to beat yourself up after an interview because you're sitting there thinking, I wish I'd said this, I wish I'd said that. But, like we've mentioned throughout this process, there's no right or wrong answers. But, if you can identify with an area that you think you didn't elaborate on, write it down, keep that for yourself for next time. Just keep that for yourself for next time. The other thing as well is it's important. So I think hopefully you've been given the decision where you've been successful, they've called you, great. And on the other end of the scale, the results might not be what you've expected where you have been unsuccessful. Always remember to ask for feedback, because that's really important, whether you have been successful or unsuccessful. It's really important because obviously it allows you to sort of find out exactly where, what didn't quite work out for you and how you can address that a little bit differently for next time. Also, if you were successful, it's also really good to find out exactly where you did well at. So it's just good always just to get that self-reflection. My first graduate job, when I interviewed, I thought I did a fantastic job. I planned, I prepared, I was on time, I did everything that was expected of me. The interview questions were what I had expected, so I did it well. And then at the end, a few weeks later, I got a call to sales and successful. So for me, it was a little bit odd. So when I asked them why, and they just, it was something that, you know, I wasn't aware of, that I hadn't picked up on. They said, I spoke too fast throughout, and that's something that I've had to take on board. Now, for me, I didn't think that, but it could be something as little as, you know, they said, you know, the questions that you answered were wild, but we found it difficult to understand you because you were talking way too fast. So that was a point for me to take on board. It's something that I hadn't picked up on. So by asking for that feedback, it was something that they were able to tell me that I wasn't aware of. So hopefully, you know, there might be things that you're not aware of. So just ask for that feedback. So moving on. So we're drawing to the end, but just want to tell you, next week we will be hosting our next series, so week three. So next week, Thursday, 23rd April at 11 o'clock, we'll be having a webinar session on personal brand and commercial awareness. So it would be about discovering and how to best market yourself. So it's a really good and interesting topic. So please do try and join in and sign on. The links will be out as well for you. So if you are interested in that, please do register. So now moving on, gonna introduce you to my colleague Rich here. So Rich, if you'd like to take away, he's going to give you a quick introduction of himself, and then we will have a few questions for him. So Rich.
Hi everyone. First of all, thank you to everyone for joining today's call. I'm really pleased to have been able to join you. So I've been with Grant Thornton now for about 10 years, and I started with the firm back in 2010, and my role for the first couple of years was to spend the majority of my time out on campuses, at universities, in schools, talking to students about the graduate and school leaver opportunities that we have at Grant Thornton. Over the years, my role's changed in a number of ways, and now work with a really fantastic team, of which Matt and Rush are both a part of. And we're responsible collectively for recruiting about 1,500 people into Grant Thornton each year, everything from summer interns and work experience students all the way up to partners and directors into the organisation. We're also very lucky to be part of a global network of member firms, and my team, as well as recruiting people into the organisation, also sends our current employees on international assignments to other Grant Thornton member firms and brings them into the UK from the other direction. So at any one time, we maybe have 50 or 60 of our employees on secondment in places like Australia, the US, parts of South America, who are gathering new skills to be able to bring them back to the UK to help develop the UK practice.
Okay, thanks, Rich. Okay, so I've got a couple of questions for you before we answer some more questions.
Right.
So, Rich, as an interviewer, what is your favourite question to ask and why?
Really great question. I think if I'm focusing on early careers and entry-level opportunities, so looking for a graduate or a school leaver, one of my favourite questions is probably one of the simplest as well. So I ask a candidate, tell me what you know about the work that we do for our clients and the skills and the behaviours that you bring that mean that you'll be high performing in this team and role. And what that does is a number of things. First of all, it checks as to how good a listener the candidate is, because actually, even though it's a very simple question, it's made up of two parts. So first of all, it tests the research that an individual has done around the work that we do for our clients. Does this candidate have a really good understanding of what it is that we do and what it is that the role that they're applying for does on a day-to-day basis? It also then tests the self-reflection that individual has done. Does this person know what they can bring to this role and how their skills match? And ultimately, it's about connecting the two parts of the question. So the understanding and knowledge of the role, the understanding and knowledge of their own skills and behaviours, and how those two things connect. And that's one of the best questions, I think, to really get some great evidence from candidates for student and graduate and school leaver roles.
Yeah, I agree. That's a really good question. Okay. So, Rich, what do you think makes a good first impression?
It's probably going to be a recurring theme throughout the responses to this, but it's candidates who are well prepared and have done their research. The points that you both made earlier in the presentation were absolutely spot on in terms of, before you come to an interview, make sure you've researched the role, researched the organisation, and figured out what makes you passionate about that role and what makes you passionate about the organisation. As well as someone being personable and friendly, and that instant rapport, it's definitely the research.
Okay, perfect. And finally, what would you say are your top three tips for interviews?
My top three tips, I think, would have to be, again, I'll talk about it very quickly, but do your research, check out the organization on their careers website, but also their corporate website. Check out the reviews on Glassdoor. Check out their careers page on LinkedIn as well. If you know who's interviewing you, refer to their profile on LinkedIn as well to really understand what it is that they do at the organization. And the final two top tips are be interested and be interesting. So be interesting. At some point in the interview, someone will maybe ask you, what do you do outside of work? What do you do to relax? Tell me a little bit more about yourself. Yes, be prepared to talk about evidence and examples of what you've done maybe at university or school or group projects, but also be prepared to talk about yourself, share what you're passionate about to really help the interviewer build rapport with you. And the final point is be interested. At the end of 99% of interviews, an interviewer will ask you, do you have any questions for us? If I think about the most impactful interviews that I've been a part of, it's when candidates have got really intelligent, really thoughtful questions that they've saved up for the end that really show that they've done their research. They show that they've listened to things that you've said maybe throughout the interview. And they're asking those thoughtful questions so that you can have a really great 5 or 10 minutes at the end of the interview to really help build their knowledge and to further build that rapport.
Okay, thanks, Rich. I think there are some really great tips there. Thank you for that. So I hope you've all jotted those down. Now we're going to take some questions from yourself. So I think you might have been adding questions, entering questions, and so we're happy to answer any questions that you might have. Can I also just say, there will be a quick survey at the end. So if you get a chance, can you please fill that in as well?
Brilliant, thank you, Rich. So now we've got time for a few questions that you've all been answering into the question box. There has been one in particular around, will the recording be circulated afterwards? The answer is yes, that will be on our Grant Thornton training website within the next couple of days. So please keep a close eye out for that coming through. So I do have a few questions. So let me just have a look. So Rich, I'll give this one to you, if that's all right. Yes. I usually struggle in the group activities at the assessment days I've gone to. What advice can you give to tackle this?
Great question. And group exercises are one of those things that's a little bit harder to prepare for, but you can still do some preparation. So think about the role that you might play within that group exercise. Will you take on a role of maybe a natural leader who leads the conversation from the start, who really helps unpick the task that you've been given for the wider group and maybe assign parts? You don't have to play that role to be successful in a group exercise. You may take a role in terms of keeping people on track throughout. So could you be the timekeeper? Could you give people a warning when there's maybe 10 or 15 minutes left at the end? What we're also looking for in a group exercise is respect for the other people in the group. People often have the assumption that to do well in a group exercise, you have to be the loudest person within that group, or you have to do the most talking. What we're actually looking for is people who are respectful, who share the floor with the other participants within the group exercise. If you've got a quieter person within that group, asking someone else what they might have to contribute is a really great thing to do. And as well, there's something around not panicking as well in a group exercise. Yes, it's a little bit staged because you're in an assessment day environment, but what this aims to do is really find how you would cope in a real life scenario at an organization like Grant Thornton. So the task is normally quite similar to the type of projects that you might be involved in at the organization, and the group dynamic is of course similar to the group dynamics that you might work in. So it's about being natural, not panicking, just treating it as like any other group that you might be part of, maybe on a university or school project, or in a part-time job that you've had before. But think about the role that you want to do and stick to that role. And remember, if you do take on a role at the beginning of a group exercise, for example, timekeeper, remember to stay on that task. The number of times I've seen someone say, I'll be timekeeper, and then you never hear from them about the time again, it's surprising. So make sure you commit to something and continue delivering.
Yeah, brilliant. Thanks, Rich. And I've got this question has come up a few times today. So, Rich, And Rich, you might want to answer this sort of between your balls, but in the current situation, a lot of organisations are starting to set up virtual assessment centres. So how might this look and how can they evaluate us if it's not face-to-face?
Okay.
Great question. Rush, do you want to start?
Yeah, so I'll start with, we touched upon digital interviews in our webinar today. So that could be a starting point as well. So what it kind of looks like is normally beforehand, you know, it's as daunting as it is, because sometimes there's something nice about having that personal feel or being able to meet somebody face to face. But I think under the circumstances, this is something to be expected. What the nice thing about, I think, you know, being able to do a virtual, it'll allow you a little bit of time beforehand. No one's going to spring anything on you. An employer will probably give you an agenda beforehand. This is what to expect. So as you would with any other interviews, you just go and plan around that. So for example, you could have done a digital interview piece. It's really important if it is going to be online that you check that your your technical equipment is working. It could be, you know, treat it as you would any other kind of a group activity or some kind of a virtual experience day. I think just make sure everything's to hand. You'll be given the opportunity and they will give you something, you know, they will give you some information beforehand on what to expect. So just take that information, do some research and plan and prepare around that. You'll find that a lot of the employers, as you know, once they've invited you to that, they'll probably send out a Q&A with that, an information guide, and send you some relevant links as well. So utilize any kind of resources that they're sending you.
The only thing I'll add to that, great suggestions, Rush. The only thing I will add to that is the reason large employers like ourselves run assessment days for our trainee roles is because it really helps us test how a candidate will act and cope in as close to a real life scenario as is possible. Now, the current situation is forcing large organisations to be as agile as we have ever been and to think about new and different ways of working. Mm-hmm. So actually doing an online virtual assessment centre is actually a very close to real life example of how we're working with our clients at the moment. So we're doing audits virtually, we're giving tax advice virtually, some of the advisory projects that we're working on are all being done virtually on Microsoft Teams or on webinars. So being able to see how a candidate responds and reacts in this kind of scenario is actually a really great opportunity for us to test a candidate's agility and their ability to cope in a uncertain situation like the one that we're in at the moment.
Brilliant. Thanks, Rich and Rush. So moving on, we might just do an extra 5 minutes, just to about 10 to 12, just to get through a few of your questions. We won't be able to get through all the questions. However, don't worry, we will send out sort of a spreadsheet of all the questions that has been asked in today's session. So Rich, this one is for you. So apologies, there will be sort of a mixture coming to you in a second, Matt, as well. But Rich, would you recommend disclosing a disability before or after the interview stage?
I would definitely encourage an individual who's got a disability that might mean that they need reasonable adjustments made to a recruitment process to flag that early in the recruitment process. A lot of large organisations like Grant Thornton are really committed to building diverse teams of people mm-hmm. within our organisation, and for us to be able to do that, to give candidates who might need some adjustments within the process the best possible chance of succeeding is if candidates feel comfortable having those conversations with the recruiters early. We also do a lot of data capture right at the beginning of our application form, where candidates can let us know things like a disability, their ethnic background, their social mobility responses. What this helps us do is monitor and measure how good a job we're doing at diversity and inclusion a year later when we're measuring the recruitment season that we've just been through. If you do want adjustments made, it is best to have that conversation with your recruiter so those adjustments can be made.
Brilliant. Thanks, Rich. Matt, this question's for you. So what questions should we ask our potential employer at the end of an interview? Mm. So what do you think would make a good question?
I'm not too sure who asked that. I think that's a great question. So thank you very much for asking the question. I think what you should certainly do is actually turn the questions back actually on the interviewer. I think you should ask them what they like about the organization. Ask them about the type of work that they get involved with. I think I'm guessing that all of your career progression will be very important. You can ask them what does good look like? So, you know, by that, you know, how do you get sort of different promotions? So is it actually just by exams, or is there anything that you need to do actually within the job? I think also you should ask, and you know, ask, you know, the type of work that, you know, you will get involved with. You could perhaps even ask them, you know, sort of the interview from their own perspective. Do they feel that there's any sort of challenges that they're currently encountering that they could do better as well? And I think sometimes what you want to do is give the interviewer the opportunity to talk. And it goes back to my initial point that I made earlier in our seminar, that actually this is a really good opportunity for you to interview them. So really think about, you know, your, and I think Rich touched on it earlier as well, be mindful of the questions that you ask at the end, because again, this is going to give you the opportunity to think, actually, this company is for me. They do the type of work I want to get involved with. They give me the career platform that I can actually take to better myself. But again, I think it's a really good opportunity for you to find out more about, you know, the person as well. Actually, you might think, do you know what, the organization's great, but I can't work for this person. And actually, there's nothing wrong with that at all. So say, for instance, if you were to take, for example, external audit, it's a huge area. Yes, you might not click with the interviewer. And do you know what, there's nothing wrong with that at all. But you might think, actually, I really want that career in audit. So look for a different part of the business. So again, just use that opportunity to find out as much as possible so you can make the informed decision. I can't stress enough, it's the interview process is two ways. It's not all the employer that holds all the cards. So do, you know, think about yourself, be mindful of yourself as well. Hope that answers your question.
Great, thanks, Matt. So I think we have time for one more question just before we go on. So Matt and Rish, you both sort of talked around the STAR technique. So this question states around, sometimes I find it difficult to answer all questions using the STAR technique. For example, when describing an achievement that I'm really proud of, how do you think I can go about this using that technique?
Okay, so also, you know, the thing about answering an achievement, the achievement doesn't always have to be, it's always good to have an example in mind. I think the best way to answer that question is if you can think of a specific example. And remember, you don't always have to draw an example from like a previous job. It could be something personal or it could be something academic related. It's really good to sort of break down the question as well with the STAR technique and just think of something for each of those elements of the question. So my advice would be always have an example that you can think of, something that you enjoy talking about. And I think that always makes being able to answer that question with the STAR technique a lot easier. If it's something that's of interest to you, something that you've enjoyed doing, like I said, if it's an achievement, try and pick an achievement from something from a personal aspect of your life.
I think I'm so sorry, I'm going to sound really boring about this again, but please make sure you practice. The amount of people who don't actually practice, and you can certainly see that, I'm sure that, you know, as interviewers, we've all encountered this over the years. You can actually see people are literally trying to think about the start. So it's a case of, oh, I'm trying to think about situation and task. It's a case of, oh, God, you haven't practiced this, have you? And, you know, so we don't want this to be as tick box exercise. So, you know, very much think about, you know, what you've done, but please do practice, you know, get a relative or a friend. There's nothing wrong with being sort of over prepared. If anything, I think as interviewers would prefer that.
Brilliant. Thank you, Matt. So Rish and Matt, I will hand back over to you just to close the webinar. And as mentioned, any questions that weren't answered, we will get those across to you all within the next couple of days. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you, everybody. I hope you found today useful. As Ursula mentioned, if there were any questions that we couldn't answer today, we have collated them, so we will look at getting them back to you. If there's any, like, and there will be a recording available on our website if you did want to that. We will be hosting another series next week, so if you did find if you found these useful, please do look on for that. There is a little bit of information, as you can see on our screen, about ways of staying in touch with us. Our website is on there. We are on LinkedIn. LinkedIn and we are on Instagram. So do follow us where we do provide regular updates and do provide some useful information around sort of employability skills as well. There will be a survey at the end. So I think I've mentioned it a few times now. So we'd really appreciate it if you could provide us any feedback, because we would like to take it on board and we're really interested in hearing your thoughts on how you found this as well. So thank you so much from me and Matt.
Thank you very much for your time and best of luck moving forward.
Yeah, good luck, and hopefully we'll see you at one of our experience days soon. Thanks, bye.